The Spinoff Podcast Network.
Are you making the most of your KiwiSaver investment? Generate is an award-winning KiwiSaver provider with a track record of strong long-term performance. Making a smart decision now could add tens of thousands of dollars by the time you reach retirement. Book a no-obligation chat with a Generate KiwiSaver advisor today at generatekiwisaver.co.nz/getadvice. A copy of the product disclosure statement is available at generatekiwisaver.co.nz. The issuer of the scheme is Generate Investment Management Limited, and of course, past performance does not guarantee future returns.
I'm Toby Manhire, and this is Juggernaut, the story of the fourth Labour government. A podcast in six parts.
Doesn't give my opponents much time to run up to an election, does it?
This nation is at risk.
What do you think you're up to now, you perverted little liar?
I could smell the uranium on it as you lean towards it.
The most radical overhaul in the history of New Zealand's administration.
Juggernaut, the story of the fourth Labour government. Made with the support of New Zealand On Air. Listen now on the Spinoff or wherever you get your podcasts.
This is The Spinoff at 100 Hours GMT with an emergency podcast. Bill English, leader of the National Party of New Zealand, has resigned. Kia ora tātou, I'm Toby Manhire. That's Ben Thomas. Hi, Ben.
Hi, Toby.
Annabelle Lee isn't with us today.
Bill English took us all by surprise. She wrong-footed us.
Explained that she was picking up some cousins from Canada from the airport, which sounded, I don't know. It's just it's normally like that kind of my girlfriend lives in Canada thing.
Yeah.
I'm not persuaded. Thanks very much to Alice, who's producing us today. Bill English has resigned. As mentioned, Simon William English has decided not to get up again. And that will create a vacancy as leader of the opposition. Bill English, Ben Thomas, was it the right time?
It was a time. I mean, I think it was pretty inevitable that he'd have to go at some point during this 3 years. Mm. You could argue... Should he have given more of an opportunity for hitherto unknown National Party people to stamp their mark on the public and you know fly their flag as potential leaders? Should he have given plotters more time to kind of concoct their coups? Should he have stayed on to ensure that charter schools survived? Well, he did that. There's never a right time. They have to get. National has to get over the next opposition leader, you know, and Labour had to go through a number, you know, Phil Goff, David Cunliffe, Andrew Little, before they found the right formulation. You know, it's a difficult task, and you've got to start at some point. So there's no right time.
Do you think that we'll talk about Bill English a bit more in a moment? But do you think that the next leader of the National Party will be the next National Prime Minister?
Kind of depends who it is. there's always the option that the next leader of National may be the next National Prime Minister, but they may not be the Prime Minister in 2020. There's no way of sort of, you know, predicting how these things will go.
People don't have, I think it's a bit like English Premier League managers. People's patience for people sitting around as leader in opposition for a long time or even losing elections is very thin these days. I was just sort of doing some back-of-the-envelope stuff to think about who was the leader of a parliamentary party 7 months ago. And most of the squad, apart from Winston Peters, James Shaw and David Seymour, have changed. But if you actually, in doing that, I was looking at the leaders of parties who led their parties to parliamentary representation in 2014 and 2017, the only one in common was Winston Peters. So it's just the turnover, I reckon, based on that very small bit of survey, is quite high.
It's something to do with the media culture that we live in now, right? It's almost kind of the same way that in conceptual art, the concept is the art, you know, and you kind of actually manufacturing a piece is sort of an afterthought. So too in politics, you know, you say, now that the speculation has begun, this will build its own momentum. Mm. And just kind of by saying that, it's done. Mm. You know, it's very performative. Mm. And so the actual time necessary, you know, to make these things a reality, you know, collapses down into almost nothing. I think we're still doing a bit better than the Australians, who sort of, you know, cycle through at a kind of, you know, rate of, you know, one every few years. I guess the only thing you can really take from that is that whoever English's successor is probably doesn't have, you know, 5 years to make their mark.
Thank you for your Derrida level analysis, Ben Thomas, there. Let's talk about Bill English a little bit. He raised the media culture thing in his departing press conference, which he was surrounded by family and various national MPs on their tippy toes. It was quite an emotional speech he gave. A few tears there, particularly when talking about sacrifices made with the family. He described his legacy, I suppose, or the points that he alighted on particularly were the stewardship as finance minister through the GFC, through the financial crisis. And he made mention of social investment, which is his kind of main policy innovation, I suppose. Excuse me. And the other thing, and then he talked about being prime minister as obviously being a career highlight. How are you measuring his legacy, Ben Thomas?
Yeah, I think you'd hit all of those main points. There probably wasn't a lot that he would look back on, you know, with a huge amount of sort of, you know, end of life kind of fondness up until the last national government. He was a good finance minister. What he really did there, and when he talks about the stewardship and custodianship of the economy, a lot of what he did was changing the path of spending away from the previous Labour government. And this is something that Labour complained about throughout 9 years of opposition, that he essentially gave government departments less money to spend than they probably expected they would be getting. That was very important, put us in a good in the good debt position, which Grant Robertson has been claiming as Labour's own, you know, this month, you know, when people have been looking at possible economic headwinds ahead. So that was important. You know, he's a very careful custodian of the books. In terms of social investment, I think we've probably spent about 9 years trying to figure out, is it a thing?
Mm.
I think on balance, social investment is probably a thing.
The concept is the art, Ben.
Yeah, and it's essentially basically just a re-explaining of the social welfare model, which is trying to find people who need help and helping them, which has been what welfare has always been about. But this kind of adds this, you know, minority report kind of algorithms to kind of slice and dice the population in different ways, you know, for targeting that help. It didn't really get off the ground in the way that he was probably hoping. You know, the government was probably a bit cautious and a bit slow getting it moving. But it's probably not as controversial also as a lot of people, you know, seem to be portraying it latterly. You know, in a way, it's just using modern tools for the same sorts of things the welfare state has always been for. The third thing, which is again part of this sort of legacy, which Labour seems to be sort of slightly kind of dismantling, were these better public service targets.
Yes.
Which was the revolutionary idea that the public service would do a better job if they knew what they were meant to be trying to do. Mm. Which, if you've ever been part of a government department doing a big project, you will know is actually pretty outrageously new as an idea. Just instead of having sort of huge 40-page strategies, just having a one-line target, which is we want to reduce rheumatic fever by 50%, or we want the number of people reoffending to go down from 25% to 10% or something like that. We want 100% of kids vaccinated. It's very rare to find targets that are that obvious and that clear in the public sector. you know, government departments can spend millions of dollars and years on what they call problem definition. And so it's a big help if politicians can just come along and say, this is the problem and this is what we want you to do about it. Mm. And then when government departments are working with each other, they can always refer back to that one sentence or that one bullet point and say, are we getting closer to the goal? So this was probably the most simple thing he did. It was also probably the most revolutionary. And the government, the Labour government, seems to be backpedaling a little on that.
Well, you know, they scrapped it ostensibly.
Yeah, well, they've said that they'll bring in their own targets, and as long as those targets are clear, you know, you should achieve the same kind of result. But I think it's important to keep the public sector accountable. You know, a huge part of New Zealand is the public sector. You know, it's the crown, and with the amount of money that we put into them, it's a good idea to know what they're doing. And this was something that was a lot more important, I think, to English than his predecessor, John Key. And it's something that, you know, the new government will have to keep an eye on as well.
So next we have a fortnight-long contest, really, unlike in other parties that we might name, such as the Greens, who are currently have a contest underway in which they go to their membership. The Labour Party, as of the last 5 years, go to their leadership in the same way that the British Labour Party does. The National Party keep it in-house, very in-house, in caucus, and only caucus members get to vote. How's it going to play out? I mean, remember last time when John Key stood down, there was a sort of, after all that kind of famous discipline over all those years, there was this sudden burst of a little bit of what felt like kind of private briefing and back channels and all that sort of thing, and it was quickly shut down, disappeared, you know. This time, is it likely to get messy at all? What do you think? How's it going to play out?
Well, there's already been a lot of private back chat and briefing, you know, obviously over the last week or so on
gone mad, obviously. Yeah.
But I think Jamie Lee Ross, the National Whip, hasn't made any comment about the process that will be adopted for selecting the leader. But what you can expect is that there'll probably be a vote on the leader, a vote on the deputy leader, and a vote on all of the whip positions. So just basically a clear out at the top, which means replacement for English. Almost certainly, I'd say a replacement for Paula Bennett, the current deputy, who really owes her current position to the patronage of English and before him, John Key, rather than kind of wider popularity in the caucus. I think it'll be a free vote. I think unlike Key's replacement with English, that it probably will be contested. The two names that sort of keep bubbling up as the major contenders seem to be Simon Bridges and Amy Adams. I think you could probably bet that Judith Collins will at least test the waters, and a couple of others who have been said to be putting their names around privately are Mark Mitchell, Jonathan Coleman, and Nikki Kaye, I think, is, you know, another person who's an obvious contender.
So let's run through a few of those contenders. We have on the spinoff.co.nz hastily thrown together power ranking of the potential contenders. And I had at number 8, Jonathan Coleman, which I just don't think is going to happen. He flew a flag last time round.
That's right. And it got a surprising amount of expressions of support, you know, because of what you were talking about, these kind of, you know, national backbenchers sort of blinking in their first moments in the sun, freed from the kind of almost complete control of the caucus by John Key, did think, well, why haven't we been consulted on this handover to Bill English? And they were kind of casting about for a bit of a stalking horse, and that was Coleman. He had a number of people sort of throw in their lot with him initially, but that kind of evaporated. And I think it would be a mistake to think that showed huge personal support for Coleman.
Not going to happen. Yep. Mark Mitchell, you mentioned Mark Mitchell, maybe Todd Muller, that kind of little rump group with Alfred Ngaro and Chris Bishop as well.
The Four Amigos. The I really hope John Key doesn't go into branding post his political career. That is the it's the worst name for a political faction.
They recreated that fish and chip photo as well, didn't they? The one.
Did they?
Or did I imagine that?
Bill English and Tony Ryle and Nick Smith, the Brat Pack, they recreated the fish and chip shot from the 80s with McDonald's in the 90s. Right. And that was, I would have thought that would have warned most people off. Did they get like kebabs in Cuba Street or something?
Maybe I'm making this up.
Tapas?
I don't know. You mentioned Nick Smith, and it does seem like an opportunity, as long as we're going through some of the contenders, for Nick Smith to finally escape the shadow of Bill English and prove his true credentials to lead the country.
I have always considered that Bill English is a good man. I think he's a man of great honour. I'm very disappointed that he's leaving Nick Smith alone in Parliament. I mean, this is kind of like if old Yeller's family saw that there was something a bit off about him and just moved to a different farm. You can't just like leave him there in Nelson while Bill rides off to a position on an Australian bank or something. This is terrible.
Tied to a lamppost in the middle of the desert. So Nick Smith is in there. Stephen Joyce.
Well, he's been interested in the leadership before, but I would have put him in that camp along with Paula Bennett of, you know, people who really have been elevated by leaders. And that's not to say for no reason. I mean, Joyce is
phenomenally smart guy.
Very smart guy. I think the National Caucus might think that a lot of responsibility and power was put with Joyce and with Paula Bennett, you know, from the point of that Northland by-election on, and there's been pretty diminishing returns from them to the party.
Paula Bennett then, deputy leader, former deputy prime minister, not widely regarded within the caucus as having had a terribly good campaign.
No, I think that's right. So she's had policy roles since 2014, And that didn't always meet with sort of widespread approval, and also sort of high-level strategy roles in the Northland by-election and the 2017 election. So it's interesting because about a year and a half ago, those two were the most mentioned in terms of, you know, along with English in terms of taking over from Key. But now they don't really figure in much of the chat at all.
Nikki Kaye has beaten Jacinda Ardern twice in Auckland Central, has a real ability to appeal generationally to the kind of people who might feel themselves less tribal in terms of their politics, perhaps. She doesn't seem too dyed-in-the-wool national. She's a social liberal. She's had exemptions on various things. What was the one?
When she opposed mining on Great Barrier Island.
That's right. So the green, a green blue.
And something to do with trees as well, I think.
A tree thing. She had surgery for breast cancer last year and took some time out, so she may not feel as though the time is right. Maybe her time will roll around in the next iteration.
There doesn't seem to be much of an indication that she's particularly hungry for the job. On the other hand, there didn't seem to be much of an indication that Jacinda was, as she steadily stepped over a pile of corpses of sort of Annette King and David Shearer and Little towards the her coronation. Well, that's right. She's had surgery. She's a breast cancer survivor. She may have other priorities now. She may have a bit more perspective. On the other hand, that's usually the sort of thing that ironically makes you more attractive to voters and more relatable.
And maybe it's not always the concept, it's sometimes the art. She might just be a better rounded person after going through that experience.
Yeah, and look, Nikki Kaye she's a very good politician. She's, I would say, the hardest working electorate MP I've ever met, and one of the hardest working ministers I ever came into contact with. There's no doubt that she could foot it in the job. It's interestingly enough, some people have talked about, she may be a bit too young, a bit too inexperienced. Well, obviously she's the same age as the Prime Minister. But also, she's been in Parliament as long as Stephen Joyce has. Yeah. She's only been in there 3 years less than Paula Bennett has. Yeah. This is almost a decade now. So I wouldn't rule her out. At the same time, I think she may rule herself out.
She may have ruled herself out by the time this podcast is put out onto the internet Judith Collins, who has been talked about in terms of leadership challenges in the National Party since the Middle Ages. She's the kind of... She always seemed like someone who would be best placed if the kind of Key-style leadership had collapsed around them, that sense of a lack of vision, the sense of being... trying to be every person to everyone, that sense of being, you know, nth degree pragmatic, a little bit of ideological steel and backbone. I'm not sure that's quite what they're looking for in the National Caucus, but I don't know, are they?
National can't just wait for their turn in government. You know, Labor did that for eight years and it never happened. You know, they're not riding a trend where National is going up and Labor is going down and the Greens are going down, and inexorably in 3 years, whoever's leading National will be the Prime Minister. So they can't rely on that sort of thing. You know, they will need to change something. If it's, I mean, Judith Collins is an extraordinarily good politician. She's very good in opposition. And she's very good at sort of moderating her tone as well. You know, she can be extremely vicious, extremely brutal, and very funny and self-deprecating as well. And one of the problems that National faces, I mean, the biggest problem National faces is the Prime Minister. And I don't think that, led by Joyce, you know, they have had any really cogent way of attacking or undermining Jacinda Ardern since she became the leader of the Labour Party. One of the problems that they have is that a lot of their attacks are seen as gendered, or that they're cautious about making attacks that might be seen as gendered or sexist. If you have somebody like Judith Collins, who, you know, has, you know, whatever else is in her political past, she's always been a strong advocate for women. Nikki Kaye's in the same boat. Amy Adams is in the same boat. They may, you know, that may be seen by the National Party as the sort of path of least resistance and giving them an in that they wouldn't otherwise have, or at least sort of removing some of the caution around, you know, trying to take on the Prime Minister directly, which at some point they're going to have to do in the next 3 years.
Amy Adams, we mentioned. I sort of had her down as being a kind of compromise candidate, someone who, but is that fair? I mean, is she more than that? I've even mentioned Phil Goff as a kind of parallel, but is she something more than that? She does seem like a safe pair of hands, someone who could guide the party through to the next election, even without necessarily wanting to rock the boat particularly.
Well, she's from the South Island. She owns a farm. She's also a commercial lawyer and quite a successful one. So she appeals, you know, kind of across a lot of those bases that you want to hit. She's very well connected within the party. She did a very good job as the Minister of Justice. One of the things that people draw attention to is she did a lot of great work on domestic violence as Minister of Justice, and she also very incongruously managed to wedge the Labour Party in its first few days in government on paid parental leave. So they actually think,
in terms of fathers,
In terms of, yeah, whether fathers should be allowed to take some of that 26 weeks of extended parental leave as well, and left Labour looking a bit stranded and less liberal than National. The only question there is, you know, can National ultimately outflank Labour on the left? I mean, I don't know if that's the right approach. But, you know, she's certainly a competent politician.
Simon Bridges, who has sort of surged into pole position, that might be overstating it. He's had a really good start to this parliament. And he snookered Chris Hipkins and the Labour Party in terms of numbers available for the election of the Speaker. Got quite fired up, you know, like in a way that people weren't used to seeing him.
He showed a lot more energy in opposition than he did in government. And, you know, look, part of that is the different demands of the roles. But, yeah, he's really impressed, I think, in his first few months in opposition. It's interesting. People will, you know, pick out the weirdest things about him, like his strong New Zealand accent and, you know, his hair. And And some people say, you know, the public won't relate to it. Some people say, you know, it's very John Key, it's very middle New Zealand, makes them much more relatable. So, I mean, it's hard to say. If you strip away all of that stuff and just look at his performance, he'd be one of the front runners on that basis.
Pretty good. I mean, you think of something like Transport, where he took over from Jerry Brownlee, who was seen as a kind of antediluvian chain dragger on, you know, whereas he was, you know, the rest of the party wanted to go forwards more quickly in terms of developing it. And he you know, he got a reasonable amount of respect in that, I think, across the board.
Yeah, I think he did quite well with the CRL in Auckland. And importantly, you know, there is that generational change aspect, which I think, you know, will be a real focus. You know, he's either 39 or he's just turned 40.
41.
Is he 41?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Maybe 40, something like that.
I think he's 40.
He's 76, and, more than 76.
And
41.
Yeah, and like Nikki Kaye, you know, he hasn't beaten the Prime Minister in an election, but he's been paired with her on TV for about nine years now.
He's sprightly. He definitely represents a generational change when you look and hear, look at and hear him, right?
Yeah, that's right. And he put himself in the frame by really running the deputy competition quite close when Key resigned and English was elevated. So,
and that didn't look insolent or, you know, insubordinate to do that, that he ran that quite well without, you know, I mean, just comparing Coleman's thing, which seemed weird.
Yeah, that's right. You know, he didn't overplay his hand, but he sort of clearly put his hand up and that was rewarded. You know, he got a big promotion in cabinet, three or four spots, and the economic development portfolio. So he's clearly regarded as somebody who's sort of earned his stripes a bit. And there's been a lot of chat about him, which suggests that his organization is a little bit further advanced, perhaps, than some of the other candidates.
So if you look at Bridges and you look at Amy Adams, Judith Collins, Paula Bennett and Nikki Kaye, who I've got down as the five front runners. You may quibble about Paula Bennett, but just for argument's sake, one of the interesting things about that is that none of them is a white guy, which is interesting, you know, and so it does feel like this is going to change New Zealand politics a bit more. We've been through quite a kind of seismic shift in terms of the, not identity politics per se, but in terms of the kind of character of New Zealand politics. It's going to happen. It seems unstoppable.
Yeah, well, that's right. I mean, what did Morgan Godfrey said that, you know, the lead, there's, what is it? The deputy leaders of pretty much every major party and or the leaders, you know, apart from the Greens, are Māori.
Yeah.
So, you know, Parliament really has changed, you know, pretty drastically over the last sort of 9 years or so.
So, 2 weeks to go, put you on the spot, Ben, Derrida, Thomas, who will be the next leader and deputy leader of the New Zealand National Party? He is literally stroking his chin, listeners. That is literally what he is doing. He is giving his goatee a tickle.
I think it's way too early to call.
Oh, come on.
It's 14 days. 14 days, Toby. Okay. Look, I think it'll clear out to
Bridget. Annabelle wouldn't hesitate. Annabelle would just go straight in.
She'd say Bill will still be there. He'll hang on.
I didn't
on.
Want to bring that up. No, I wasn't going to bring that up.
I didn't, no.
Didn't bring that up.
None of us can see the future.
Carry on.
I think it'll clear out to Bridges and Adams, I suspect. I think Adams, I don't think that the deputies will be brought from, you know, from the pool of potential leaders. I don't think we'll see a kind of accommodation like we did between, Brash and Smith, you know, kind of bringing the kingdoms together. Mm. Somebody like Todd Muller might come in. It depends if
as a deputy.
As a deputy, yeah. There isn't enough time, you know, because we're so early in the parliament, it means guys like Muller don't get to sort of, you know, put their hands up because they're just not well known enough by the public. It'd be as ridiculous as trying to explain to the public that their new prime minister was Jonathan Coleman, a year ago. But
He's stroking his chin again, listeners.
Yeah, I...
He's fading.
It won't be Paula Bennett. It will be a clear out. Yeah.
I think you're right. I think it'll be Bridges and Adams in some configuration or the other. So that's clear. That's all sorted. Thank you for joining us for this emergency podcast. Thank you, Alice, for producing. Next time we'll be back with Annabelle Lee and hopefully with Waimea Rose. Till next time.
Talo for Lover. I'm Madeline Chapman, editor at The Spin-Off. If you have the means, consider supporting our high-quality journalism by becoming a Spin-Off member. Sign up now at thespinoff.co.nz/donate.
Are you curious about how business can be better? I'm Simon Pound, and I host Business is Boring, a podcast where I caught it all with some of the most interesting people in entrepreneurship, commerce, and making things happen. Tune in to Business is Boring every Tuesday, brought to you by the Spin-Off Podcast Network in partnership with Spark Business Lab.
The Spin-Off Podcast Network.